A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Tuesday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polian. Our top story. The leader of the parliamentary opposition has given the prime minister 60 days within which to get parliamentary approval for a loan by local firm Fresh Start Construction Company Limited. Feeling this, the leader of the opposition is threatening to get a declaration from the court that a recent government contract awarded to the company is unlawful and in violation of the Finance Act. The announcement follows threats by the opposition to table a no-confidence motion in parliament against the prime minister. And 1 week after the SLP staged a protest march against government's plans to privatize the island's public health sector. DBS's Sheffield Gillard begins our news coverage.
The leader of the opposition has written to the Prime Minister expressing concern about a direct purchase contract awarded to Fresh Start Construction Company Limited in March 2017 for the resurfacing of roads in the Prime Minister's constituency. At issue is the failure to open the $15.9 million contract up to bidding and the acceptance of the estimates provided by the company. The contents of that letter were read out by Viewfort North MP Moses Jebatis at a press conference on Tuesday.
The facility made to the government of St. Lucia by the company is a loan. As such, therefore, the approval of the Parliament of St. Lucia is required for this loan pursuant to Section 39 and 41 of the Finance Administration Act.
Opposition leader Philippia says the transaction was not brought to Parliament for approval, a move he says is designed to allow for scrutiny and transparency of the terms of such contracts. But more than his concerns about the failure to seek parliamentary approval, Philippia is worried about what he sees as a rapid accumulation of debt and an increase in borrowing. He is bothered that this is happening at a time when central government's fiscal health is expected to decline.
At the end of 2017, the public debt was $3.17 billion. According to the budget summary, it is estimated that the government will borrow $300 million for the fiscal year ended 2019.
The opposition is calling for a halt to the borrowing and for the government to be more forthcoming about its handling of taxpayer money. That call for transparency also extends to the plans for the health sector. Pressure continues to be applied for the administration to heed the advice of the Medical and Dental Association on the way forward for the St. Jude and OKEU hospitals.
The government needs to give the people of St. Lucia an update about the transitioning from the Victoria Hospital to the Owen King EU Hospital and the status of the staff at the Victoria Hospital.
Attempts by the administration to calm fears sparked by recent social media claims of widespread job losses at the hospital have met with only limited success. The opposition, though, is counting on the act passed by the Labour Party while in office, which will provide enough protection and relieve some of the anxiety being experienced by the medical professionals. In the meantime, it says it will continue to be vigilant and to hold the government accountable. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
In other news, the body of Botham Jean is to arrive in St. Lucia this week. The rest of his family is also due here by the end of this week to finalize preparations for his burial. The Justice for Botham team has planned a special homecoming reception for the family of the 26-year-old who was gunned down in his own apartment by an off-duty Dallas police officer who claimed to have mistaken his apartment for hers. Jean's mother, meanwhile, has called regional leaders to make a bold statement to the United States that such actions will not be accepted.
The grieving mother says she is heartened by the outpouring support for the family from across the island and indeed the globe. St. Lucians all over the world have been joined by others outraged by Botham Jean's death. Together, they have staged several vigils and protest marches in a show of support for the family and to demand justice. 26-year-old Botham Jean was inexplicably shot and killed the night of September 6 by an off-duty police officer, Amber Geiger. She reportedly mistook his apartment for hers and shot him in the chest, thinking he was an intruder. Ms. Allison Jer spoke of the importance of Prime Minister Alan Chastney's visit to Dallas following the shooting incident.
At a country level and at the highest level of the Prime Minister, who met the mayor and met the district attorney and several other people, that, you know, it's a major concern. What I think has to happen now is to take it a bit further, and we could call on the OECS and CARICOM to make a bold statement.
Botham's body is expected to arrive in St. Lucia sometime this week. Family members are expected back on island on Friday in order to prepare for funeral services on Monday. As a result, organizers of the Justice for Botham group are calling all St. Lucians to be part of a homecoming plan for the family.
What we have planned is we've worked with several community leaders along the route going back to Castries, where all we've asked is for group members, schools, community members, just to line along the path while they've been escorted back to Castries, just with a sign saying, "I stand with Botham," with a flag, with his favorite color, red. Just anything that will pay tribute to the life of Botham, but also, more importantly, to show solidarity.
Ms. Antoine says the mandate of the group is to ensure that Botham's case does not die with him.
The media in America is going to die out. We know that how it works. The cycle changes. The media is going to die out. We not hear Botham in the media anymore as much, unfortunately, as much as we're hearing now. So this is where the team comes in, for us to continue to agitate, for us to continue to make Botham's case on the forefront at all times.
Amber Geiger, a police officer for 4 years, was arrested 3 days after the shooting incident and was charged with manslaughter. She remains on $300,000 bail. Rallies are being held across Dallas calling for her dismissal and for her to be charged with murder. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
We continue the broadcast with news that the head of the St. Lucia National Trust continues to call for dialogue with the government on its proposal to establish a dolphinarium in the north of the island. The trust is opposed to the move based on its potential environmental and economic impact. The fact that a growing list of countries such as the United Kingdom and the United States are shutting down dolphin parks has raised concerns that the establishment of a park here could negatively affect tourist arrivals from these countries. More in this report.
The director of the St. Lucia National Trust says it has heard the rumors that the government is proceeding with the project despite the trust's objections. But he says those are just rumors. The trust has requested an update from the government at least twice, but is yet to get a response.
But we hear all these rumors about the project moving forward. I mean, the government has promised transparency, and this is a case where the government is being rather opaque. If the project is to go ahead, we explained in our letter that the setting it up will have impact on our operations at Pigeon Island, and we need to plan for this. But that said, we are still acting on the assumption that the government still wants a project.
The St. Lucia National Trust, in the meantime, is continuing its campaign to educate the public on the implications of the move and to discourage the government from pursuing the establishment of the dolphinarium.
You have seen as well the letter from the SLHDA in which they are talking about the mood of the British traveller as it relates to dolphins in captivity. We are hoping that these things will cause a rethink of the project. We don't know where they plan to put it, to where off Pigeon Island. We don't know where the land-based facilities will be. The rumour is that it will be somewhere between Pigeon Island and Landings and Sandals, which is a place that is used by so many St. Lucians. So access to that place will become restricted, if not closed. Is that the best place for the facility? that place was left for use by the public in perpetuity.
Apart from the livelihoods which will be impacted, the trust is concerned that the project could deny citizens of this country access to one of the most popular beaches at a time when beach access is becoming increasingly constrained due to hotel and other developments. Tulsi does not believe enough thought has been given to the potential implications of the project by the government. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Chayla Mendez reporting.
And now this. The opening of a special sexual offences court and additional training for lawyers, judges, magistrates and other court officers are among priority areas for the Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court as it celebrates the start of the new law year 2018-2019. The new law year began with its usual ceremonial opening in the form of a special sitting of the court in St. Christopher and Nevis. There were simultaneous special sittings in the other 8 member states and territories of the OECS. Sheffield Gillard has the details.
The Chief Justice, Her Ladyship Dame Janice Pereira, delivered the opening address in which she spoke about the impact of Hurricanes Irma and Maria on the court. The storms destroyed parts of the Northern Caribbean. In the months following the storms, appeal hearings had to be conducted using technology in the form of video links and, where possible, in-person appearances in court. E-filing was also highly utilized.
This speaks to the heights which can be achieved and the possibilities which can become realities when there is a will to do so.
She says 1 year after the devastation, Dominica's judiciary and the island by extension are still struggling to restore some sort of normalcy to their operations. The court infrastructure was severely damaged, with judges and court staff being rendered homeless. A number of records have been lost or damaged, not only in Dominica but other states.
Although disasters may cause the court to bow, disasters should never be allowed to cause the court and access to justice to become broken. Out of the depths of adversity, there are always positive and enduring lessons to be learned. It also brings forth that positive human desire to innovate, create, and seize opportunities. It only remains for us, in turn, to turn these desires into positive action in moving forward.
Other matters addressed were a proposal for the opening of a special sexual offense court to deal with specific cases of sexual offenses and judicial training for lawyers, judges, magistrates, and other judiciary officers. The president of the St. Lucia Bar Association admits that she is excited about the prospects of the new law year 2018-2019.
Our expectation in this new law year is to embrace whatever that was enunciated in the theme for this law year. The challenges, opportunities, and resilience. We cannot be left behind. The world is moving, as you know. In fact, the world is quantum leaping, and we cannot do things as before.
The theme for the opening of the new law year's address is challenges, opportunities, and resilience, the ECSC paving the way to a modern and efficient judiciary for the Eastern Caribbean. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Street Vibes. Why is it, do you think, that people cross the highway with oncoming traffic instead of using the walkover?
That's typically human beings. They're very hardened. They like the easy way out. And at the end of the day, the overcross, maybe somebody afraid of the heights. But again, human beings. So let me take a little chance to cross the road because a vehicle not come in. But a vehicle not feed in. Like on Sunday with the incident, that young man could have avoided that, take his time, exercise, and walk on top of the overpass because they put it for all of us to pass.
But when I check people, you know, like St. Lucians, they have that in their habit, you know. They don't like to, you know, to go the long way. They're always playing, they're making a shortcut. Just like in the park, you know, to see how they're passing on the grass and they have footpath. So, you know, so accident will always happen to them.
Yeah, but it's easier. I would not want to take a walk over. I'm afraid of heights like 10 dogs. So, you know, I'd rather just cross one time and get on with my business, try and do something else about it.
It's carelessness. Or maybe they think it's quicker and some, well, like me, I'm afraid of heights. But I'll not take the risk because sometimes as soon as you cross.
So you'll take the height instead?
I'll take it because I like myself.
Because they're crazy, they have a highway that they could pass and they just run across you like when they could just get something high. When some other countries don't have what they have, they just don't want to put it into good use.
We've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down near the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, a veteran journalist decries an incident in which a reporter was ordered to shut up at a United Workers Party press conference. The government considers the possibility of decentralizing mental health care services. Welcome back to the DBS News World, and thank you so much for staying with us. A veteran journalist and newspaper editor has reacted to an exchange between United Workers Party supporters and a journalist at a press conference on Monday, during which the reporter was told to shut up. Former editor of The Voice and Mirror newspapers, Guy Ellis, says it should never have happened. Sheffield Gillard tells us more.
Reporters were asked to shut up by an invited guest who apparently was not pleased with the line of questioning. Former editor of The Voice and Mirror newspapers, Guy Ellis, believes this should never have happened. Press conferences, he says, are intended for journalists. He says the media's job is to get the information from the various organizations and to then relay to the public. What transpired on Monday, he says, is unacceptable.
I don't think members of organizations, be political or social or sporting, whatever, have a right to be at a press conference and to be taking part in a press conference to the extent of engaging the media and picking quarrels with the media. I don't think that is acceptable at all.
Opposition leader Philip Pierre shares similar sentiments. Press conferences, he says, are for the press, and political meetings are for the supporters.
The media practitioners and talk show hosts should openly see who they support. But to have the semblance of balance when all the historical facts show you not balance is what worries me. If you listen to Fox, Fox says, listen to me, we support the conservatives, we support Donald Trump.
Chairing Monday's press conference was General Secretary of the United Workers' Party, Oswald Augustine, who raised a few eyebrows himself when he appeared to suggest that it was the job of the media to make the government look and sound good.
Not everybody's on social media. Not everybody reads. But if you can come in front of that television and on that radio and give out this information, our government will look a thousand times better. And that's where you in the media comes in. To make your government, it's our government, to make our government look better for the good of St. Lucia.
The media has its role to play, and we've always accepted the role of the media to do whatever it deems right in its professional opinion. So we do not get involved in that. We speak to the media, we accept the criticisms of the media. Sometimes we listen, we take it. That's the media's job.
The Media Association of St. Lucia was unavailable for comment on the matter. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Government is discussing the possibility of decentralizing mental health care services. The announcement was made at yesterday's UWP press conference. Here is Don Nicholas with that story.
Decentralizing healthcare would mean that depending on the gravity of their situation, some persons who are mentally challenged will be able to access care at locations closer to their homes. Political attaché to the Prime Minister Norbert Williams says many international agencies are heading in that direction.
I do know for sure that there has been discussion about decentralizing mental health care. And that has been pushed by a number of international agencies.
Mr. Williams added that this would enable relatives to get more involved in the recuperation of their loved ones.
Because it is felt that better care can be rendered with having these patients in closer proximity to their family. There's a better support structure, and this would be referred to other agencies, other health facilities around the island.
The statement on decentralizing mental health care was made at Monday's press conference by the United Workers' Party. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The Department of Transport and the Traffic Police are repeating calls for pedestrians to make use of walkovers rather than risk crossing busy roads. The warning follows an incident on Saturday in which a man was struck by a car while attempting to cross the John Compton Highway. The accident happened near the busy junction, mere feet away from a walkover. We hear more in this report.
According to Officer 582 of the St. Lucia Fire and Emergency Service, the male victim, said to be in his mid-20s, sustained multiple injuries and was transported to the Victoria Hospital, where he is presently in stable condition.
This single patient who was involved in the incident was transported to Victoria Hospital as quickly as possible with a suspect of multiple system trauma to that patient. We do not have a name at this time, but we know it's a young adult male, approximately 20, 25 years old, who was involved in that incident.
The Royal St. Lucia Police Force and the Ministry of Infrastructure are encouraging all pedestrians to use the crossover structures put in place specifically to avoid incidents like this one. Crossing the busy highway among speeding vehicles has become a common practice for many.
Too many times we've had incidents of pedestrians crossing the main highway, especially in that area, taking the chance of not using the appropriate walking area, that is the crossover, and taking the chance of crossing the median, and the chances are very highly likely that you would get hit.
Officer James notes that some persons are afraid of heights, but he says overcoming that fear has now become a choice between life and death, or at the very least, serious injuries. For the DBS News World, I am Chayla Mendes.
We continue the broadcast with news that the chairman of the National Committee on Reparations is calling on local authorities in the wider region for more cooperation and assistance as it relates to reparations. Mr. Ilboske made the comments following news that a university in the UK is creating a center for the study of slavery after receiving benefits worth the equivalent of up to £199 million sterling from slave trade cash.
According to Mr. Buske, this is not the first time this has happened. He recalls just last year, another university in the United States revealed that it had received similar donations and contributions from slavery. Similar approaches can be taken in St. Lucia and the Caribbean, but he says the Reparations Committee in St. Lucia, which was established in 2013, has been dormant and not getting the assistance needed from government.
We do have a Reparations Commission. The majority of CARICOM member states have national reparations committees. Unfortunately, in the case of the St. Lucia and a couple of other territories, there is an absence, either a total absence, as in our case of government funding and support, or the governments will, as we are witnessing, have appeared to have lost the steam that once existed in pursuing Britain and European Union for reparations.
He noted that before such payments can be made, things must be put in place in order for external entities to be called upon to do what they really should.
We have to keep up with the flow. And if the flow today is one where universities and institutions in the UK, in Europe, and in North America are prepared to atone and to admit the things that they can no longer hide and lie about, then it is impossible for us to be able to put our house in order.
In July 2013, CARICOM took the historic United decision to engage the governments of the United Kingdom, France, and Holland on the issue of reparations for native genocide and slavery. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Promoting St. Lucia as a meetings and conferences destination. The details in just a moment. The Ministry of Health and Wellness, with the support of key stakeholders, is working to come up with ways to encourage members of the local LGBTI community to be more open about their sexual behaviors with health professionals. Glenn Simon explains.
Based on a recent population size estimate survey, groups such as men who have sex with men, transgender, and female sex workers are very reluctant to disclose their sexual behaviors to family, friends, and health professionals. Disclosure and concealment of sexual orientation or involvement in sex work is closely associated with factors such as stigma, confidentiality, and social support. Gaining a better understanding in the OECS of how best to facilitate disclosure while protecting medical confidentiality is a critical task if the subregion is to achieve the 90-90-90 target set by UNAIDS to help end the AIDS epidemic. In this regard, the Department of Health and Wellness, in collaboration with the OECS HIV-TB Elimination Project, United and Strong, the Caribbean Vulnerable Communities Coalition, and the University of Alabama, undertook a pilot initiative referred to as Motivational Interviewing to better understand and address key population disclosure in St. Lucia. A two-day workshop was facilitated by Contact Flex coach Maurice Bulls of Behavior Change Consulting.
This guiding style of motivational interviewing was the key because they felt like we were partners. We felt like we were on the same page. And that's what they're learning here. Like, okay, we've been doing so many things already, but partnership is the key. And really being in there and understanding their perspective and coming from, especially coming from the same culture.
Bennett Charles, Communication and Advocacy Officer with United and Strong, Inc., expounded on the benefits of this training.
Tailored motivational interview, I think it's going to cover, assist us in a number of ways. We've done two major research pieces in the Caribbean recently, well, more the OECS. The barrier survey and the PSE survey really showed how clients thought about the services. One, they thought that the services were very rigid and very autonomous, and the services were not very engaging. And so what the MI is going to do, one, it will assist nurses and other healthcare professionals in being able to have a more client-centered approach in terms of how we engage the clients, how we get information from the clients. It will be more conversational, so clients will be more open. The other thing, if clients are more open, they would be more willing to at least, one, if they have issues with the medication, they will be able to speak to you a lot easier. So it will encourage adherence and will also encourage disclosure. And so we're hoping this training will equip the participants with the necessary skills to allow the clients themselves to be more open, to be more engaged, and really at the end of the day, to be able to have retain more people into care, because that's one of the big issues.
It is hoped that a more comprehensive package of services will be offered to clients in St. Lucia, stemming from this partnership with the CVC, the University of Alabama, and Behavior Change Consulting, among other partners. The workshop commenced September 13th at the Pastoral Center in Marysville. For the Ministry of Health and Wellness, Glenn Simon reporting.
The St. Lucia Tourism Authority has hosted the first major initiative promoting St. Lucia as a destination for meetings, incentives, conferences, and events. Over a dozen meetings and event planners were flown to the island to learn more about the island and to demonstrate to major corporations why they should consider holding meetings and conferences here. We have the details in this report.
It was a festive Friday evening at Tapas on the Bay, and these meeting and event planners were just beginning to get a Friday night feel for the destination.
So they're here, all of them, we have 14 of them. It's everybody's first time to St. Lucia. It's a couple of them first time to the Caribbean. So they're looking for new places for their companies to introduce new destinations. And they're looking at, and all of them have groups for 2019, 2020, 2022. So because they plan about almost a year in advance. So they're here to experience the destination to see what St. Lucia has to offer for their clients.
This is my first visit to St. Lucia. When I got the invitation to apply for the post MICE FAM, I jumped on the opportunity and I wanted to come see what it was all about and how I could promote it and sell it to my clients.
This familiarization trip is also intended as a networking opportunity for destination management companies and hotels selling vacations and incentive packages to large corporations in the United States and Canada.
We have people from Utah, we have some from Arizona, we have Tennessee, we have Illinois, we have Georgia, we have somebody from Montreal as well, and somebody from Massachusetts, from the Washington DC, so I'm all over the US.
When it comes to selling to my clients, I think the first thing we see is just the beautiful, wonderful personalities, the gorgeous weather, the fantastic scenery, and that's really what it's all about. It's about those experiences that you don't get to have at home. It's just the simplicity of the island actually is what really is just most amazing to me.
Increasingly, corporations are seeking exotic destinations to hold conferences and meetings. Some are considered rewards for teams that have performed outstandingly. The meeting planners will network and experience for themselves the island's hospitality, sites and attractions, and the quality of conference facilities. They're also having fun.
Being able to come here and enjoy it firsthand and being able to see the destination from top to bottom has been great because we've been able to experience it and being able to go back and explain everything that we've seen and everything that we've done.
The SLTA says some of these meeting planners are finalizing itineraries for 2009-2020 and St. Lucia is included. Having experienced the destination firsthand, they are in a better position to develop more unique programs and boast the advantage of direct contact with local industry players. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Chela Mendes.
Sports is next when the DBS Newsworld continues. Finally from us, on the lighter side, a Delaware man who won a $50,000 Powerball jackpot was unaware of his winning status until he read an article in the news 3 months later. The 69-year-old man told Delaware lottery officials he read a news article about an unclaimed $50,000 prize from the June 13th drawing and realized he had tickets he had not checked. The man said he was shocked to discover he had been holding on to the $50,000 ticket for 3 months. The winner said he has plans for his winnings. I plan to pay off some bills and put some in the bank. I'll also spend some of it on an old car I've been fixing up, he said. That's a broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polian, wishing you a very good evening. See you next time.